Good morning, Evelyn.
Good morning, Donna.
It's wonderful to have you over here this morning.
Thank you.
I'd like to start with, if for the record, you could please state your full name.
My name is Evelyn Ruth Tyler Cooper.
Tell me about the Tyler part.
Well, the Tylers came from the Henry Sampson was a 16-year-old passenger on the Mayflower, and his granddaughter married Hannah. His granddaughter Hannah Sampson married John Tyler. So that's where the Tylers came from, and they settled down in Medford, Massachusetts.
Do you have any idea of when they may have started to come west?
Oh, they came in about 1660.
Mm-hmm. And settled in Vermont?
Settled in Vermont, yeah. Mm-hmm.
What do you recall of your father?
Oh, I recall a lot of good things about him. He was a farmer, and we lived on part of the Dickinson farm, which is off of Route 5 in Brattleboro. And these Dickinsons were wealthy people from New York who bought up property, a big mansion. And I understand they wanted to pick their neighbors, so they bought up the adjoining farms. And my dad and mother settled on one of the farms.
And your father's name?
Was Eddie. Not Edward, just Eddie. And in school, I always had to correct the teachers. Your father's name, Eddie? You mean Edward? No. Eddie, E-D-D-Y? No. Eddie, E-D-D-I-E. Eddie Charles Tyler.
And your mother's name?
Was Mary Wallace Barrett Tyler. And she was a twin. Her sister's name was Mildred.
And where was your mother from?
Well, she was born in New London, Connecticut. But they moved up to, her father was a farmer also, and he was managing the Bradley farm in Brattleboro, a big dairy farm, which now is underwater because of the Vernon Dam.
Do you know when that might have happened, the dam?
Ooh, let's see. I'm not sure the exact date, but probably in the mid-20s. Mm-hmm.
That must have been upsetting to see it go underwater.
Right. But they needed the water for power. You know, and they built an electric power plant down in Vernon. So these meadows were flooded.
Do you have any idea how your parents might have met?
Well, that's a curious thing. My brother and I have been discussing it and wondering. Dad went to Mount Hermon for 1 year to learn agriculture. And we were wondering, in fact, I've called Mount Hermon to see if maybe they placed their students afterwards, but they don't seem to have any record of that. But he ended up working on the Bradley farm where my grandfather managed. And, of course, he met his daughter.
The boss's daughter?
The boss's daughter.
Tell me a little bit more now about growing up. I understand that you lost your mother at a very early age.
Yeah, when I was 2. She died of a ruptured appendix, which apparently, you know, in those days they didn't have penicillin or anything. And I don't know whether her upbringing as a Christian Scientist prevented her from getting medical attention. That never was told me, but I've just been wondering in my own mind. But I know she went to the hospital and died in the hospital. So.
And your father, did he remarry?
No, he never remarried. And he had two or three different... Oh, my mother's sister, twin sister, was living with us. But then the love bug hit her, and she went off and got married. So Dad had two or three different housekeepers. And then when I was in the second grade, 7 years old, a friend of ours came to live with us. We always called her Aunt Mary, although she wasn't any relation to us.
Do you know her last name?
Her name was Staver, Mary Staver. And she was a lovely person, very nice. And she was a single woman and just took hold very well.
How long did she stay with you, approximately?
She stayed with us till I was a junior in high school. And then she became ill. But she was a good teacher and she taught me how to housekeep and clean and do the laundry and so forth. So then I took over the keeping of the house for my dad and brother when I was a senior, and then I took a postgraduate course, so for 2 years I was keeping so that my brother could finish school before I went into nurse's training. In fact, I couldn't go into nurse's training then because I was a year too young.
Did you ever follow your father as he did his chores?
Oh, yes. My favorite thing was springtime. And his chore on the farms was to make the maple syrup. And he was in the sugar house boiling it down, stoking the big furnaces with wood. And oftentimes on the weekends, when it was lunchtime, Aunt Mary would make up his lunch and Stuart and I would take it up to him. And he'd say, "You want a drink of warm maple syrup?" So he'd pull off a little bit and we'd drink it right there. Can you imagine drinking sweet syrup? But it was delicious. And then, of course, he was always raised all our own vegetables. And he had his team of horses, which he did the work around the farm with. And he just loved those horses. And I remember one time one of the horses was sick, and I can remember him staying up all night with it just to make sure it was treated well.
Were there other animals on the farm, too?
Oh, yes. We had pigs and chickens. And the cows were over at another farm, which was connected to this Dixon farm. And so we would walk over the hill around the corner to get our milk at what we called the farm. And then the men would cut the ice. There was a pond back of our house and between the next house. And in the wintertime, they cut the ice there and brought it to the ice house and packed it, the big cakes, with sawdust around to prevent it from melting. And then in the summertime, they'd bring in a big chunk of ice and put it in the ice box of our house. Of course, you had to make sure you didn't let the pan overrun as it melted.
How long would a block of ice typically last?
Depending on how hot it was, of course. But, I would say 3 or 4 days, I would think. I'm not exactly sure.
Was the refrigerator or the ice box kept in the cellar?
No, it was in a back room, like a back pantry off the pantry. I can remember. We were at that house for 10 years, and I can remember that.
This is the house that you were in when you were
born.
Very young.
Yeah, that's where I was born. Yeah.
Tell me about that house. Take me through it. Take me into the front door, or
Could go in the front door, and there would be sort of a hallway, and then to the right, a living room, and then another room to the left, a downstairs bedroom, then stairs going up. And I know I had a front bedroom, and it looked over to the east, and we were about a mile or so away from the Connecticut River, but then we could see Mount Wantasket across the river, and most every summer, somebody carelessly set a fire there. But you couldn't convince me that fire wasn't going to jump across the Connecticut River and burn my house down.
So you were a little girl sometimes looking at that fire from your window.
Yes,
being
yes.
a little scared of
yes,
what might
was.
Happen.
Right, right. But there were picnickers or, hikers that would carelessly drop a cigarette or something or leave a smoldering campfire.
And the kitchen, was that towards the back of the house?
Yes, it was. Yeah, the kitchen. And, of course, no central heat. There was wood stove. Of course, we didn't have to worry about taking out the trash, because if you had an extra piece of paper, you just put it in the wood stove and it was gone. And we had a big stove, a chunk stove in the living room that heated the rest of the house.
What kind of a stove?
We called it chunk stove. Instead of having small pieces of wood, you had a chunk of wood. You might call it a portion of a log that would fit. It was cut purposely to fit in there. And that's one of the chores the farmers had to do, go out and cut the wood and then stack it. And we stacked it in the woodshed. And my brother's job was to help keep the wood box filled. We had a wood box in the back by the kitchen stove. But, and so the girls worked in the house and the boy did the outside chores.
So there was a stove, a chunk stove in the living room, and then a stove in the
kitchen.
Any other stoves?
No, that's all the heat.
How did the heat go up to the bedrooms?
Well, I think there were, if I remember right, something like open registers or something. But I do remember on real cold nights, they'd have a chalk stone, put it in the oven, and they'd take it upstairs and wrap a towel around it to warm your feet, the bottom of the bed, under the covers. That was nice.
Would you wear some woolies to bed?
Yeah, flannel pajamas, right. And so what else is? I know we had a nice dining room, and as I can say, the pantry was big. And then down the basement was a root cellar, which beets and carrots were kept in a pack of sand so that they wouldn't spoil. And also chickens, when they were abundance of eggs, Aunt Mary would put them down what they called water glass. I'm not sure just what that is. It would preserve them so you could use them for in a wrong crock. And then in the wintertime, she'd use those for baking. You wouldn't use them for eating fresh, but use those eggs so they, when there was an extra abundance of eggs. And of course, then we had a lot of chickens for food. And Dad would butcher a pig once in a while, so we'd have pig.
How about the chicken? Who would kill the chicken?
My dad would, and once in a while we'd see him chop his head off and it would go fluttering around. And then, of course, he'd have to put it in hot water to pull out the quills.
How about turkey? Would you ever eat any turkey?
We didn't raise turkeys, so we must have bought those at the store. And I can remember it was about 3 miles into Brattleboro, and every Saturday night my dad would go down. We'd go down with him to buy the week's groceries, which, really was just basically, the bread and cereals. I know they made some butter at home, but not all of it. Maybe lard, bought lard, because pies were made, crusts were made with lard, which is a no-no nowadays. And I can remember when I was a junior or so in high school, my dad would give me $5 to go get the week's supply of groceries. My girlfriend used to laugh at me. I'd go across the street to save a penny on a loaf of bread.
How about beef? Did the family eat any beef?
Oh, yes. We ate beef, yeah.
Where would you buy that? Or?
No, I think over the farm where the milk was raised, they would butcher a beef and then distribute it between the three farms.
Did your father hunt at all?
Oh, yes. He liked to hunt. And he didn't very often get a deer, but once in a while he did, and we'd have venison. And I can remember Aunt Mary making mincemeat out of the venison. And then he always liked to go for gray squirrels. And then springtime, the first morning when trout season opened, he'd go fishing. And he'd bring home nice rainbow trout and clean them. And Aunt Mary would cook them. Very good. Yeah, he was, and as I said, a rabbit. He'd get rabbits sometimes too, and they would taste more like chicken.
Did you and your brother help your father at all in the fields?
Oh, yes. Especially when it was haying time, and go out, he'd be raking up the hay, and then he'd pile it on the hay wagon loosely, bring it to the barn, and then get up on the barn, pitch up into the hay mow, and sometimes we'd be up there, help pulling it to the back part of the barn. But I know sometimes when the day was done and we were out in the field with him, and we'd each have a rake, he says, "Don't carry the rake. Rake the grass, because you might get another mouthful of hay for the cows or the horse." So,
your father had an expression that he used often about a farmer being tied?
A farmer's tied to the cow's tail, because he couldn't go off very far because he'd have to be back in time to do the milking.
Tell me about some of those summer Sundays you'd go for a ride.
Oh, yes. After he got the morning chores done, he'd say, "Let's go for a little ride," and he'd find a back country road, and Aunt Mary would have pancake batter mixed up and some bacon, and he'd go along beside of a favorite spot in a brook and make his own little fireplace, and then put wood in there and start a fire, and we cooked the pancakes and bacon over the fire, and that was a real treat. And you don't do that nowadays, but he grew up in Marlboro, which is not far from Brattleboro, and so he knew these backcountry roads and a nice cold brook, and you stick your feet in it and be refreshing.
You mentioned going to the store with your father and sometimes alone. Did families typically make their purchases with credit or cash?
Oh, my dad never had credit. He never bought anything unless he could pay cash for it. And even though, to my knowledge, he was only getting, of course, he had his room and, he had his lodging and all his vegetables and everything, but he got $18 a week. That was his pay. Every Saturday, the foreman would come down with his money, $18 a week. So.
And that was your father's life's work,
yes,
is that correct?
Yes, right. That's what he always did.
You mentioned that your mother had been a stenographer.
Mm-hmm. She'd gone to Bay Path down in Springfield. She graduated from Brattleboro High School in the class of 1915, and then she went to Bay Path, and I think she was there at least 1 year, not whether it was two. Then somehow she got a job in Washington and worked as a stenographer in Washington for one of the Vermont senators. But then her mother became ill in 1920, so she came back home to help take care of her. And then she didn't return to Washington after that, because my parents were married in 21. So
your parents were married just a few years before your mother passed away.
Yeah.
Did you know your grandparents at all?
Well, I knew my grandmother, Tyler. I didn't know my grandfather, Tyler, because he died 3 weeks before my dad was born in Marlboro. But my grandma Tyler, I knew her very well. And she was a very kind lady. And the thing I remember about her was we used to visit her on Saturday nights when we went into town to buy our groceries. She was living in town. And she was ill the last time I saw her. She just said, well, you can come and have lunch with me when I get better. And that was a big thrill to me because as a student, I was a bus student and had to carry my lunch. And the children who carried their lunch weren't allowed to go off the school grounds at noontime. But Grandma Tyler lived just down the street from the school, so I thought, oh boy, I'm going to go have lunch with her. But she passed away, and that never did happen. And that's the first thing I remember about a death in the family. Seems an odd thing to hang on to. But then my grandfather Barrett was a nice gentleman with a mustache that we'd sit on his lap and twirl his mustache. And my dad would say, oh, don't let them do that. And he said, oh, I like it. But he was the groundskeeper for these Dickinsons on the big farm where we lived. And although he could have his newspaper delivered to him, he insisted on having it delivered to our house, so every night he had an excuse he'd come down to see Evelyn and Stuart.
What did he look like? What size man was he?
Well, he was a small man, but he never had real gray hairs, brownish hairs, I remember, and this mustache. And he was just a very kindly gentleman. Short, rather small in build. As I said, he was a great gardener, and he took care of the garden for Mrs. Dickinson.
You mentioned that your grandmother, Tyler, was widowed early.
Yeah. Oh, yes.
Did she ever remarry?
No.
How did she manage as a young widow with children?
Oh, she went back to live with her parents, who lived in Marlboro, the Johnsons. And she went out because she had three boys, my dad being the youngest. And she went out taking care, like a midwife or a housekeeper after children were born. She would help out in homes, and that's the way she earned her living. And so the boys were really brought up by the Grandpa and Grandma Johnson.
And for the record, your grandfather Tyler's full name? Was it Eddie?
My dad's name was Eddie Charles. Eddie?
Lewis?
Yeah, Eddie Lewis Tyler, right.
And your grandmother Tyler's
was Addie Johnson Tyler.
And then on the other side, your grandfather's name?
He was Herbert Moses Barrett.
And then?
And his wife's name was Jenny Murphy Barrett. And I was impressed upon me that the Murphys came from Ireland, but be sure to know that they were the Protestant Irish, and they came from the Northern Ireland.
Any idea where in Ireland they might have come from?
The northern part, and I have the name of the town in my records, but I can't recall it right now.
When you were growing up, were there some family traditions, for instance, around the holidays? How would Christmas be typically celebrated?
Well, we always put up the Christmas tree. We went out and got the Christmas tree in the woods and picked it out ourselves, usually spruce or balsam, whichever Dad thought looked the best, bring it home. And to my amazement, we used to put on lighted candles, clipped with a small candle like a birthday candle, and we lit those. How come we never had a fire? I don't know. And then we would make cranberry rings and popcorn, string popcorn to put on it. Of course, we always had our Christmas gifts there. Santa Claus came. As I say, and the Christmas tree always smelled so good because it was so fresh. And the balsam's fragrance.
Would you have a meal at your home?
Oh, yes.
Or somewhere else?
No, we usually had it at home there. And oftentimes, my dad's middle brother, who was a bachelor at that time, would come up. He was a traveling salesman, Uncle Oscar. And if it was convenient, he'd come up for Christmas. But there was one sad Christmas when he was married and had a little boy, and they were coming up from Texas, but they came. He had Texas plates on his car, but he was coming from Pennsylvania to visit Grandma Tyler. And at the Bernardston Cales Crossing in Bernardston, they didn't see the train, or it was in a snowstorm, and the train hit the car, killed his wife and 2-year-old son. But Uncle Oscar survived, and then he sort of adopted us as his family. So he remarried many years later.
Was that his only child who died?
Yes. Well, then later, in his second marriage, he had 2 children. But this little boy died there. And now that's with 91, they go over the railroad crossing now up there in Bernardston. So that was Christmas Eve, 1924, 23.
That must have been a terribly tragic
Christmas. Right. But then ever after that, when he came to visit us, even not at Christmas time, he would always come with gifts. So Uncle Oscar was like our Santa Claus.
And you mentioned also that your father had another brother, Lewis?
Lewis Taylor, yeah. And he lived up in West Dummerston. He had 2 children. And he worked in the Presbyterian Granite Quarry in the mountain across West River, right across from West Dummerston. And that was quite a sight to see them drilling deep into the mountain to get the granite for the monuments, for the cemeteries. And he had 2 children, a boy, Wallace, who had 3 children, but then he got drafted into the service and got killed in France. So his wife...
In World War II?
In World War II. So his wife had to raise 3 boys by herself, but she went back to live with her in-laws, Uncle Lewis and Aunt Gertrude, so that she could go out to work and earn money.
And he had a second son as well?
He had a daughter. He had Wallace and then Doris. But it's interesting, I can't name them all the families, but there's so many families in our group that had 3 sons.
Yeah. It's a family tradition.
Family tradition of having 3 sons. Yeah.
How about Thanksgiving? Was that celebrated in a special way?
I just remember having, he probably roast chicken more than turkey, but and always a mince pie, and probably plum pudding, homemade plum pudding, with Aunt Mary's famous hard sauce on it, which was, you know, butter and sugar and egg white. That was delicious. And maybe Dad would have some of his elderberry wine. Of course, children never had any of the wine, but he used to pick some of the elderberries, the wild elderberries, and make elderberry wine, and also made some dandelion wine from yellow dandelion blossoms. He didn't partake of it much, but just to have a little bit on hand.
Did you have any favorite dishes or meals that your aunt would cook?
I know, I'll see. Pot roast, probably. And always a roast, Sunday usually was a roast chicken dinner. And I don't recall anything else that was special.
How about on your birthday? How would that be celebrated? Would there be a cake ever?
Oh, it's always a cake. Cake was tradition for birthdays.
What kind of a cake?
Well, usually a white cake with a chocolate icing. And we always, because there were two birthdays in April, my birthday was the 2nd of April, and my brother's was the 23rd of April, so April was a busy birthday month.
When you were growing up, was religion an important part of your family life?
Well, I know that we attended Sunday school, and I know that we were always taught to say our prayers before we went to bed. I don't remember only maybe Thanksgiving or Christmas saying grace before dinner, but always our evening prayers.
Who taught you those prayers?
Aunt Mary, yeah.
And Sunday school?
Went to All Souls Church Sunday school and got involved in pageants and things of that sort. And remember having angel costumes and things of that sort. And Aunt Mary was a great seamstress, so she could make up anything that was needed. And speaking of being a seamstress, she made many of my clothes. Oh, Christmas time too, she had always made fresh doll clothes. My two or three dolls had new outfits. And I know when she made my dresses, I used to complain because she always made the bloomers out of the same material. Wink and I have white.
Tell me about some of the other things you did for fun. I understand that through your childhood you kept a scrapbook.
Oh, yes. And I loved to look through the papers and like World War II incidences. And but before that, though, when the Dion quintuplets were born, that made a big impression on me. And I, every time there was a different picture of them, I would cut it out. And Dr. Defoe's, and I know in later years, when we were on a camping trip, we stopped it in Callander, Ontario, to see their birthplace. But I still have that scrapbook of different clippings from newspapers that are getting kind of yellowed. But that was fun.
How about square dancing? Was that something that you did?
I didn't do that until we got married. Then did that.
Did you go to the movies at all when you were a girl?
Well, I went to the movies when Aunt Mary, our mother's twin sister, lived in Brattleboro. She didn't have any children, and we'd go have a vacation for a week or so with her right in town. And that was a treat. We'd go to the movies. And I think one of the first movies I saw was Rin Tin Tin, the dog story. And her husband, Uncle Sid, worked for Estee Organ Company there in Brattleboro. And then I know that they lived near the organ factory, and you'd hear the noon whistle blow. Uncle Sid would be coming home for lunch.
Was there an ice cream parlor that was popular?
Oh, yes, there was Ruth's Drugstore. That from high school, sometimes we would go down there, and they had black wrought iron seats up at the round tables, or there was a soda bar too, and we'd have ice cream, and that was a special treat. Didn't have it too often because we didn't have too much money to spend for outreach like that.
What kind of games would you have played as a girl growing up?
Of course, hopscotch and jump rope. And my only playmates at the time were the people who lived next door. And there was a large family, 7 children there, Mortimer family. And the two oldest one, the oldest one and I were the same age. So we would do things together. And we'd go out in the woods and rip bark off of dead trees and pretend that we were making a house and so forth. And Mildred was going to go to, she's the oldest girl. She and I were going to go to school at the same time. But she went to first grade. There wasn't room enough for me in first grade. They said it was over-enrolled. So went to the superintendent and said, well, I think she's capable of going to second grade. So my first experience in schooling, no kindergarten, no first grade, was second grade. I still have my report cards from them, and there were several Fs there. Doesn't behave too well.
Did you have a bicycle?
No. I think I had a tricycle, and we had a scooter and a wagon. But when Stuart wanted a bicycle, and my dad said, well, we can only afford one bicycle, and that should be the boy gets the bicycle. But of course, we didn't have much opportunity to ride on our, you know, rough country roads.
You had mentioned before some of Stuart's outdoor chores. What sort of chores did you have?
Well, Saturdays was cleaning day, and you changed the beds, you cleaned the bathroom, and then swept down and the stairs. And then when I got older, I could wash the kitchen floor, and I couldn't figure out why I had to sweep it first. It was a wood floor, there would be splinters in it. He said, well, you must sweep it before you can mop it, because you'd get all these splinters and all the dirt tracked in. And what else? Well, we could help with when it was time for canning, pick the vegetables, and we went blueberry picking. And strawberries. We picked wild strawberries, and can you imagine hauling a strawberry the size of your fingernail? You didn't have much left by the time you took the hull off, but we did that. And shell the peas. And another thing, we had a big butternut tree out by the garage, or barn, by the barn. And to crack those butternuts in the wintertime, I don't know if you know how tough their shells are, and crack them with a hammer, and then take a nut pick to pick out the meat. But that was such rich, oily meat. It was delicious. And another entertaining thing, the Mortimer children and we would put on a play. And then my dad and my aunt would have to come out, and her parents would come out and watch it. We did put a curtain up over the entrance to the barn and put on a play.
You mentioned washing the floor and so forth. Did you have indoor plumbing?
Yes, we had indoor plumbing. And we had water that came from a spring, apparently, but Stuart and I were just talking about it this June when I was out in Cleveland. Wondered whether they had a pump or how it got there by gravity, but I think I can remember the spring house being up on an elevated hill, like, and it must have gravity flow down.
And but, electricity?
Oh, yes, we had electricity, and we had a telephone, and our number was 22. And you crank it up and talk to the operator, I want to call such and such a number. I can remember that.
A radio?
Yeah, and we had, we listened to Amos and Andy, and the blue coal. The Shadow Nose, put on by Blue Coal, and you could hear the door creaking and the noise. Mm-hmm. And I know it was one of them had a big speaker like that you see now, RCA speaker.
How about music in the home? Was there a phonograph or Victrola or
piano?
Yeah,
we had a crank Victrola that put records on. Not too many of them.
Explain how that worked, the crank Victrola.
Well, you cranked it up and then put the record on and put the needle down, and then it would go around and around until it ran out of juice.
It would slow down gradually.
Yeah, right, right. Uh-huh. That was interesting.
Did you have a piano in the house, or?
I think we must have, because Aunt Mary played the piano. I don't recall where it was located, but Aunt Mary was a good pianist. In fact, in her younger days, she used to be a church organist. And pianist.
How about a car?
You know, my dad never had a brand new car that I recall, but he had always had a car. And that's I had an uncle who had a roadster with a rumble seat in it. I can remember that most distinctly, going on a trip to Hampton Beach one 4th of July in the rumble seat and coming back sunburned deeply.
Was it bouncy back there?
Yes, it was. And hot and windy.
I imagine that would take a little bit longer to go in those days to Hampton
sure,
Beach.
It did. That was an all-day trip.
When did you learn to drive?
I didn't learn to drive until I got married. My husband taught me.
How about any pets when you were growing up?
Oh, yeah. We had a cat, Tommy, who had a white necktie. And we didn't buy cat food for him. He was on his own. He was a good mouser. And, of course, out in the barn, that was good place to catch mice out where the hay was and the grain. Oh, speaking about grain, I can remember Dad buying 50-pound bags or 100-pound bags of cornmeal for the pigs. And when he first opened the bag, he'd bring fresh cornmeal in. That was our cornmeal to use in the kitchen. So we had cornbread from that. And cornmeal cereal, you cook it much like you would cream of wheat. And then Aunt Mary often planned to make a little extra. And then she'd put it into a bread tin to chill overnight. And the next morning you'd slice it and cut it and fry it. And that was good with maple syrup on it, real maple syrup.
When you were growing up, you had one sibling, your brother.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Tell me about your brother, his full name.
Stuart Barrett Tyler, and he was a year and 3 weeks younger than I. And we were good playmates, I think.
You've remained in contact over the years?
Oh, yes, we've very closely. Yeah, he went to Bradwell High School, graduated. See, I was although I was only a year apart, I was 2 years ahead of him in high school, having been started in the second grade. It's 2 years ahead in school. And so then when I wanted to go into nurse's training, I had to wait an extra year after graduating. So I stayed home and I wanted to take the year off from work. My dad said, no, you better keep on studying. So I took a postgraduate course, some secretarial work, you know, typing and shorthand and so forth, which I thought would benefit me, and some extra chemistry. And then kept house for Dad and Stuart. And then when he graduated, my dad gave up the housekeeping. We put our bit of furniture in storage, and he went to work for these stavers. Aunt Mary had two sisters who owned a farm up in Marlboro, and they needed a caretaker for their garden and so forth, and they had an extra guest house, so he went there to live, and Stuart went off to, he lived in Bradwell for a year with my uncle so he could finish his high school, so he could go to work. And then he worked at Greenfield Tap and Dye, and then he heard that there was greater job opportunities out in Cleveland. So he went off to Cleveland and never returned. He said he liked the metropolitan life better than the rural life of Vermont.
And what town does he live in out there?
Well, now he lives in Mayfield Heights, which is on the eastern portion of Cleveland. And he married a nice girl, Eleanor Blahovic, who was Czech, and got very fond of her parents. I never met her until the day before she was married. And that girl was so worried for fear that her in-laws wouldn't like her. But we went, Dad and Mary and I went out by train to the wedding. And that was my first experience with a big wedding. The only other wedding I'd been to was my cousin Doris's, and it was just a simple home wedding with punch and cookies afterwards. My goodness, Eileen Stewart's wedding was a big night before party, and then the day of the wedding, and then a dinner at noontime, and then dancing, and her uncle played the accordion and music, and then another dinner in the evening.
Sounds like it was a wonderful time.
It was a lot of fun. Yeah.
And do they have children?
Yes, Stewart has two daughters. Arlene, who took up nursing and then went nights and got her master's degree and all kinds of degrees. She has been with the Red Cross, in 2 more years she will have been with the Red Cross Blood Program of Columbus, Ohio for 30 years. And she's director of the nurses down there. And she does a lot of teaching now. And she even was just going to go out to California and train others to become teachers. So in June when I was there, she told me that in 2 more years, she's going to be 55 and she's going to retire. She will have had finished her 30 years in Red Cross. And she built herself a nice home in Columbus, a ranch-type home, which I think is lovely. I think she thought with the idea of her parents, if someday they didn't want to do steps, she would have a place for them to live, because her sister, Noreen, is married and has one son. So that's Stuart's only grandchild. And Tim graduated from high school with number 5 in his class. But his girlfriend is number 4, Christy. And Tim is going to be a senior in Ohio State University this year, majoring in political science. This summer, he's having an internship in Washington with Jack Kemp and Bill Bennett, getting a paid job. So.
And his parents live where?
Stowe, Ohio. And Noreen, and his parents' names are Noreen and Ron Jones, and they're both music majors. And Noreen teaches in a private school, music and drama, and her husband teaches in Garfield Heights. He now teaches 4th and 5th graders. He did teach junior high, and he says he much prefers the younger children. And then they also do music on the side for wedding couples, and they have a business card called Take Two. So Ron will accompany Noreen while she sings. She's got a beautiful voice. In fact, it reminds me that just the 16th of June this year, I was out there to their 25th surprise wedding anniversary party. And then Ron and the girls came out a day later, and there were 75 of us that gathered at a restaurant. Arlene and her mother had been planning this for over a year to keep it a secret from Noreen and Ron. And can you believe that with all the little lies they told, they did keep it a secret. And so we had a wonderful time that evening.
I know your brother has been very involved with the family genealogy.
Yes, yes. He's always been interested in it. And then in 84, he had a stroke. And had to retire from business. He was a traveling salesman for heavy equipment. So in his retirement years, he's done a lot of research on family history. And he goes to Case Western Reserve Library and local libraries. He writes to town halls. When he comes out to visit me, his favorite trip is, we must go to this cemetery. We must go to that cemetery. I must take a picture of that stone, because he does not write anything down he doesn't have authenticity for. So, as I say, he's dug up the fact that the Tylers are the 10th generation here, And he got us into the Mayflower Society. And then he got me into the DAR because of Steven Tyler marching from Chesterfield, Mass, to Lexington and Concord in the Revolution. So that made me eligible for a DAR membership, which I've continued.
So your brother has done a tremendous amount of work for the family.
He's done it. This history has been made much easier by all the work that Stuart did, and I want to thank him for it. And he has a beautiful fan chart made up of our family, and each of the boys has a copy.
I wanted to ask you now about your father. You lost your father in the 1950s?
Yes, he died in 56.
And you cared for him, did you?
Oh, yes. Yeah. He called me up, it was a leap year day in February in 56, saying that he wasn't feeling well. Well, I'd seen before that he had lost some weight, but he just said, well, he was trying to watch his weight. And then it comes to find out he had pains. So one of the Staver girls is an osteopath, and she had checked his blood pressure and so forth and his pulse, and she said, I'm sure it's not a heart condition, but he wants to come down there. So he came down here. I went and got him, went to Dr. Freeman, and he discovered he had a colon polyp, he thought, or a tumor. So I took him to the hospital, and Dr. Manuel operated on him, and it was malignancy of the colon. And he was there for a while, and it just didn't heal. But he just decided he said, I don't want to die in the hospital. So we came back here to 35 Main Street. And boy, that was, came back, and he was done in March, and he died the 11th of May. So that was 2 months of lots of work. And Rich was, my youngest child, was only less than a year old at the time. So taking care of him and that too was a lot of work. But it was well worth it. So he passed away May 11th, 1956.
You must have been exhausted.
Oh, I was. But Russ had made a plan that I should go with our secretary, Josephine Tiffany, the next spring or next February to visit down in Florida. So Russ had all planned out that the boys would go to different homes to be taken care of by friends. And I went with Josephine Tiffany, and we flew to Florida to Indian Rocks Beach. That was my first airplane flight, leaving here in a snowstorm and getting into Florida. I thought, oh my gosh, I must have gone to heaven. It was such a shock to that balmy air. It was a lovely week, such a restful week.
Why don't you go back a little bit to your own school days?
Oh,
you
yes.
Mentioned starting school. You skipped ahead two grades.
Yes, right. Well, there wasn't any kindergarten then anyway, so I started in the second grade.
And was this a small school?
No, it's still in existence, Green Street School. In fact, I don't remember, probably 25 or so children in our class. I remember my first teacher was Miss Speed, Isabel Speed. In fact, my dad was a great saver, too, so I inherited that. Normally, I have all my report cards saved from those times.
Was it a one-room schoolhouse?
No, not here. We until I went to Green Street School in Brattleboro, which was a regular eight-grade school. It's still there now. But then when I was 10, the Dickinsons died. Or Mrs. Dickinson died. Mr. Dickinson had died before that. And so Dad was afraid the place would be sold and he would be without a job. So we moved to Marlboro and he took possession of the Stone Tavern, which I think somehow Mrs. Sadie Howe owed him some money or something, and that's the way he recouped it. So we went there to live for a couple of years. And that we went then to a one-room schoolhouse in Marlboro. And when Stuart and I entered school, we made 5 students in the 8 grades. And sometimes it would be up to 10 students, dependent on how much lumbering was being done, the sawmills around the area. So.
Who was Sadie Howe?
She was just a friend of Dad's. I think he had loaned her money just a distant friend. I didn't really know her, but my brother and I just kind of pieced together the reasons for our moving up there and thinking that she owed him money. And we were up there for 2 years, but that was in the early 1930s, and there was a lot of unemployment around then, and Dad did a little bit of handiwork for different people, did sugaring for one man, did lumbering for one man, and that's where we had goats. Our milk there was goat milk, and we had our rabbits, and Aunt Mary tried to supplement the income by opening up a little store across the street and called it a tavern, a tea room, Molly Stark Tea Room, because that was on the Molly Stark Trail between Brattleboro and Wilmington, Route 9. But we only stayed there a couple of years. But that was where we had a well, and we had to pump our water into the house. And we didn't have modern facilities. And we had to walk out a long hallway or shedway to the little three-holer. And that was mighty cold on a winter day. And then we had to prime the pump to get the water going. And then that's when we heated the water and took our Saturday night or Wednesday and Saturday night baths in a tub beside the stove.
It sounds like quite an adventure. Oh, that was almost camping out.
It was. And that was cold in that house because we only had there, again, just the kitchen stove and the stove in the living room. And the upstairs bedrooms were chilly. And the wind whistled through there because it was kind of from the back side of the house. It was quite a valley there where the wind could sweep up from the mountains.
Is that house still there?
Yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And what road is it on?
It's on Route 9 going to Wilmington and called Molly Stark Trail. And the only thing I can remember there, one summertime, gypsies stopped by and wanted to know if they could camp along the way. And I guess they were wary of them because they had been told that they might try to take things from you. So we just kept our distance from them.
Did they camp there?
They did. They went down the field. And we had a few apple trees there.
But then after 2 years, you returned to Brattleboro?
We returned to Brattleboro. My dad bought a farm out on the old Guilford Road, which now has been taken over by Route 91. If the house was there now, it would have gone right straight through our lawn property. And Dad worked for a farmer down at the foot of the hill, supplied milk to a local dairy, and Dad milked the cows down there and helped with the gardening and so forth and the hay and so forth. And that's when I was in high school. And we'd walk down the hill for about a mile and go to the bus to get the bus to go to Brattleboro High School.
Do you recall the farmer's name your father worked for?
Yes, Henry Northrup. Yeah, and he still has a nice red barn there. He has since passed away. But right near his farm is another farm, the Robles. And I can remember in the high school, the sophomores and freshmen had a rope pull, see who could pull the boys through the pond. Of course, usually it was always the freshmen that pulled the sophomores through.
In school, did you have any favorite subjects?
Oh, I liked English very much. And I liked to write poetry, and then in high school I liked chemistry very well. In fact, I think the chemistry teacher was fond of me because she gave me better grades, I think, than I really deserved.
Do you have a favorite teacher who comes to mind when you think back on school days?
Well, our English teacher, Miss Lord, was very good. And in Brattleboro High School, too, we had on the third floor was our cafeteria, and we had home ec up there. And we had to go up there for basic lunch line. And it was very simple, nothing, no hot meals or something, just sandwiches and donuts and things of that sort. Then the second floor was our assembly hall and the seniors' home room. And I know we'd have football rallies, but they'd say, please don't stomp the floor, they may cave in. The building was getting so kind of antiquated, I was afraid we'd be doing some damage.
Is that building in existence today?
Yeah, it's been now made into town offices, and there's a new high school out there right near the farm where my dad worked on Northup's farm out by the fairgrounds.
And have you,
Brattleboro Union High School now, several towns have combined.
Have you stayed in touch with classmates?
Oh, definitely. And that, we had our big, the Brattleboro High School alumni is very active. Every year they have a parade through town, and the five-year classes especially put on an effort to have a float or something special. And since our high school 50th reunion, we had our, we graduated in 39, so in 89, we had a big reunion, and one of our classmates has a big farm with a wraparound porch, and she has graciously invited us back every year for a reunion. We thought after 50 years we should reunion every year. So we have potluck meal, everybody brings something. So we have a picnic, and she provides, well, we always chip in with some money so that she has money to buy paper plates and cups and the coffee and the punch. And we just go up there about 2 o'clock in the afternoon and then have a picnic supper around 5 o'clock. And we just have a wonderful time, and everybody keeps in contact.
And her name?
Is Esther Dunkley. Esther Miller Dunkley. And she's so good. She keeps us in touch with people who have passed away during the year and so forth.
Sounds like a wonderful group of friends.
Oh, they are wonderful. And there's a couple in town that don't come, but most everybody makes a big effort. Even people from California come, and it's very, very nice.
At this point, the tape has nearly come to an end for our first hour. When we come back, we'll pick up from here, and I want to hear about that graduation trip that you had to Washington, D.C. So we'll stop for a moment at this time. Evelyn, we're back for another hour's chat here. Tell me about that wonderful graduation trip that you received when you graduated from high school.
Well, my mother's brother lived in Washington, Uncle Arthur and his wife, Aunt Grace. And they have no children. They both worked there, and they invited me and my brother to come down to Washington for my graduation visit. And I was a little bit disturbed to think Stuart wasn't graduating, but it was only fair that the two of us should go together. My first train ride, had to get to Montreal at 2 a.m. The first morning, we missed it because we overslept. So we took it the next day. And going down to Washington, and Grace and Uncle Arthur just took us everywhere. I just can't believe the things we saw in that 1 week. And she worked in the Department of Labor, so she could take us all through the government buildings. I remember going downstairs through the tunnels, the Senate and the House of Representatives, and having lunch in the House of Representatives, I think. And then, of course, seeing the Washington Monument and Lincoln, everything, and over to Mount Vernon and Arlington. And the zoo down there was fabulous. And Rock Creek Park, I think that was called. And then two for one lunch, I remember going to the automat where you stuck in coin to get out a sandwich or a cup of soup or something. That greatly impressed me. There was so much to see there.
Now, this was after you graduated from high school.
Well, it was during Easter vacation the same year. I graduated in 39, but it was the Easter vacation in April. And the cherry blossoms were in bloom. And then Uncle Arthur was later worked at the Washington Cathedral. Oh, and too, he raised roses. His hobby was roses, photography, and engineering. And he had a beautiful rose garden out back. Belonged to the Potomac Rose Society. And later years, I can't remember what year he died, but Aunt Grace had his services at the Washington, at the Bethlehem Chapel of the Washington Cathedral, and they made a, plaque, not a plaque, but sculpture, like of a smokestack, a photographer's lens, and a rose. And they mounted it up high up in the ceiling of the one portion of the Washington Cathedral. And she went with binoculars. She says, you can't really see it good unless you look at it in binoculars. But I was so impressed to think a relative of mine had something in Washington Cathedral, which now is finally completed. The building is finally completed. That's a beautiful spot.
Sounds like it was a wonderful time.
Oh, it was.
And then you came back and did one more year of study.
Yes.
And kept house. And then you were off
to nursing. Right, right. And I can remember coming down to Springfield. Had to come down to take a POTS pre-nursing test down at Classical High School in Springfield. And I was so scared coming on the train by myself to the big city of Springfield. And then going up State, I think it was on State Street where Classical High School is, and taking this test. And then I got I had been in Girl Scouting, go back a little bit, had been in Girl Scouting, and I was camping one summer, and probably late years of high school, and I met a girl from Northampton, Joanna Hathaway. She said she was going to go into nursing. And I said, well, where are you going to go? She said, I'm going to go to Coolie Dick in Northampton. And I said, well, gee, that sounds like a pretty good idea. My dad doesn't want me. Bradwell had a training school, but he thought it would be better if I went out of town. I have to take care of people I knew or practice on people I knew. So I applied to Coolie Dickinson, and so did Joanna, but she didn't get accepted. She went to Greenfield, but I came here in September. And really enjoyed the training very much. Of course, in living with a bunch of girls, which having never had a sisters, it was a different experience.
Did you have any special friends during those years?
Oh yes, there's this one girl that I've still been friends with, who introduced me to my husband, was a girl I met in training, Eva Schofield. She's now Eva Maju. She came from Somers, Connecticut. And she and I were roommates one year. My first year, I was roommate with a little girl, Rita Pelican, who came from a Catholic girls' school down in Marlboro. And she, if you want to learn good manners, you learn them from her. She was very precise about everything she did, and she, yes ma'am, no ma'am, stood up, was very polite. But then Eva Schofield and I, later two were roommates, I believe, when we went affiliated at Boston Floating Hospital. So,
what had given you the idea, do you think, to become a nurse?
I think I was just plain stubborn. When I was a child, a little child, anybody say, what you going to be when you grow up? I want to be a nurse. You'll change your mind many times. And I had a cousin who was 10 years older than I am, and Marion Barrett, Uncle Clifton's daughter, and she was going to become a nurse, but instead of that, she got married, and everybody, the family was quite disgusted with it, I think, that she gave up her career to get married. But then, I don't know, I just kept saying, I always wanted to be a nurse, so, and I did, and I'm sure glad I did, because I really enjoyed it, and even to this day, I'll see people on the street, I can't remember who they were, but they'll say, oh, you were my favorite nurse. And then my latter years was on maternity, and somebody would say, oh, hello, Miss Tyler, how are you? I'd say, well, how's the baby? I'd know that was a safe answer.
You had worked quite a bit in maternity?
Yeah, well, yes. After I graduated from nursing training, I went into surgery and worked there for a year. And I really enjoyed that very much.
At the Coolie Dickinson.
At Coolie Dickinson. Trying to, if you're a scrub nurse, you try to be one step ahead of the surgeon figuring out which instrument he wants next. And that was quite a challenge. And then we had to cover nights being in the emergency room and some of the horrible accidents we'd see come in. But that was a great experience.
And then after your surgery year, what happened next?
Well, that was during the war. I graduated in 43, and that was 44. And my girlfriend and I, Thelma, she and I decided we want to change jobs. We've been here 3 years, 4 years. Let's go somewhere else. We found out nurses weren't allowed to move into another hospital. The only way you could change jobs was going to service. So, hey, that's an idea. We'll go into the, apply for the Navy. We thought the Navy held a little higher qualifications than the Army. I don't think it did, but we thought so. So we applied for the Navy and under the buddy system. So we went in, got accepted, went down for our indoctrination down to Portsmouth Naval Hospital down in Virginia in September. We were there for 3 weeks, during which it came a hurricane. So that was our first experience with that kind of weather. We had to go across the bay to Norfolk to be fitted for our uniforms. I never saw so many people, so many service people. That was just so crowded. But they had us down there to get uniforms and also to teach us some of the naval terminology and how to march, which I never did very well, two left feet. But then we were become ensigns, officers. And that was a great experience because, you know, you were treated, seems like you were treated royally and respected. And on the wards, the boys, many of our patients, well, went back to Newport Hospital in Rhode Island. Although we had an opportunity to request change of stations, and we'd say hospital ship, California, so forth, but Thelma and I both stayed there the whole 2 years.
What was Thelma's last name?
Newell. She came from New Hampshire. But while she was there, she fell in love with a corpsman, Bernard Welch, and they got married. So, and I hear from her at Christmas time, but that's about all.
When you left the Navy, what was your rank?
Lieutenant J.G.
So you really enjoyed your Navy days?
Oh, I did very much.
Did you have much contact with men returning from overseas?
Well, most of them were fellows who had been injured in the Pacific, and they were New England residents, so they just transferred them to Newport Hospital to be cared for nearer their families. And they were so, you know, and having worked in Cooley Dixon Hospital, where especially the women patients were picky about what you did this and do that, and they were so appreciative of just the meanest, littlest things you could do for them, like a back rub or something of that sort, which was good. So we gave medications, and we had corpsmen under us that we directed to do the bathing and so forth. And then I also worked in the surgery there, and then worked on the psychiatric ward, worked with the retired officers, so captains and so forth. So it was, and Newport is a beautiful town to be in. And I can remember our first Thanksgiving there, walking on the cliff walk around the edge of those, seeing those big mansions. It was nice duty. Not very hard.
You were there how long now?
2 years.
And then what happened?
Well, then the war was over, and you could either go back in as a regular or stay as a reserve. And I decided to stay as a reserve and get out and applied to come back here to Cooley Dickinson. And they had plenty of job opportunities, so I said, well, I'd like to work on maternity. So I became head nurse on the floor of maternity, and that was a very good experience. I enjoyed that very much.
Do you remember some of the physicians you worked with?
Oh, yes. Dr. Merzbach especially, because before his time, the doctors would just say, well, call me when she's almost ready to deliver. And Dr. Merzbach, when this patient came in, he came in and stayed right in the doctor's room. And you just had to go down and tap on the door and say, hey, I think you better come see Mrs. Jones. Because I remember some of the other doctors would say, don't call me till you can see the whites of their eyes. And some of the responsibility we felt was kind of horrendous. But Dr. Merzbach and Dr. Manuel, Dr. Claire Manuel, the pediatrician, and her husband, Dr. Ed Manuel, would do some of the sections. So, and Dr. Brown, the pediatrician.
You had another good friend in the Navy, Thais?
Oh, Thais Cabral. Yeah. and I still have keep in contact with her. In fact, she winters in Florida, and usually every winter we would see each other. And then she comes up in the summertime to New London, Connecticut.
Do you recall hearing where you were when you heard about the bombing of Pearl Harbor?
Oh, yes. I was at Cooley Dixon. I was doing night duty. And that, of course, it was a Sunday. And I require a lot of sleep, so I had slept the whole day and then usually get up just in time for dinner and then go to work. And I felt, when I got up and heard that we'd been bombed, I thought, oh, gee, I missed out on a lot by sleeping. That was certainly tragic.
Did your brother serve in the military?
Mm-hmm. He was in the, he got drafted from Cleveland and was in the infantry, and then he changed to the paratroopers. And he was, we later found out, they were sent overseas to what we found to jump the Battle of the Bulge. But en route over, his ship was hit by another ship, and they had to anchor, tie up in the Azores. Many of the men on his ship were washed out to sea. In fact, a Brattleboro boy that we knew was one of the victims.
Because of the collision between
the ships?
Because
of the collision and the big hole it made in his ship. But because of that accident, he didn't have to jump the Battle of the Bulge, which was a big sacrifice for other men to have done, not have to do that. But yeah.
Did you correspond with him?
Oh, yes, I have quite a few letters from him, yeah.
Now, tell me about settling in Florence. How did you come to settle here in Florence after the war? Again, you came back to work in the hospital.
Came back to work in the hospital, and this friend of mine, Eva Schofield, who had been my roommate, had married Franny Marjou, and Franny Marjou was working for a certain milkman. And one day, they had a home up here on Powell Street, and they said, hey, Evelyn, why don't you come up for help us trim our Christmas tree and we'll have dinner, and I'm going to invite Russ Cooper up. Oh, I don't know. So I had heard about Russ owning this dairy, but that's all I knew, so we went up, and that was the beginning.
What's your earliest recollection when you think back to your husband and seeing him the first time? Do you remember where he was? Or?
Well, this was when he came to pick me up at the nurse's home down the Thompson house, and then in his, I think, picked me up in the truck, because he didn't have a car, he had the truck. And we went up to Franny and Eva's house, so, and he was very jovial and friendly.
Easy to get along with?
Very easy to get along with. And he was telling me an interesting story of how he got started in the milk business. He is, as a youngster, he lived on North Maple Street, and Bridgman's owned a dairy there. And even, I think, when he was only 9 or 10 years old, he'd go over there on Saturday mornings or vacations and, you know, like a little boy, help out and putter around the milk business. And then in high school, he had an opportunity to work for Bridgman's, and so he quit high school in his senior year, in Christmas time or December of his high school senior year, class of 35. And but I'm not sure of the sequence of it, but the Bridgman's got ill, so he really took over their business. And then he applied at Smith Charities and got one of these $500 student, it wasn't a loan because I understand he didn't have to pay it back, but with that money he helped start himself in business there. And then he, there would be many, many small dairies around and that were tired of producing or bottling their milk. Russ never had a farm, he was always the middleman. He went with his truck out to the farms, picked up these 20 and 40 quart cans of milk. And I can see him picking them up. I rode on the truck with him many times out of the coolers, and they were heavy. And bring them back to the plant and then pasteurize it and then bottle it. And then deliver it.
And the plant was?
Bridgman's up on North Maple Street.
126?
126 North Maple Street, yeah. And he would buy up different dairies, 200 quarts, 300 quarts. Then he got bigger and bigger. I guess Bridgman's had about 200 quarts or so when he started. I've got all that information written down, but.
Today, when you drive by 126 North Maple Street, it's a lovely home with a deep lot behind it and bay of garages. It's hard to imagine that as a farm. Were there other farms?
It was not a farm.
Not a farm, it was a dairy operation.
Mm-hmm.
Were there other similar businesses on that street?
No. In fact, some of the neighbors used to complain because they'd start at 4 o'clock in the morning, bring the trucks in to load them up with the milk to deliver to the homes, and they didn't like the noise that created, which, you can't blame them.
So your husband gradually took over the Bridgman family business.
Right.
Did he have a lot of trucks on the road at one point?
Well, at the time, he had it until in the late 60s. At that time, he grew, and he had 18 trucks on the road at one time, 3 wholesale and the rest were retail. And that was time when the housewife expected her milk at the back door by breakfast time, and they had milk boxes out to receive it and so forth. And sometimes, like, I can remember in the apartment houses, like the McCormick block downtown, he'd carry up what he thinks Mrs. Brown's going to want, and invariably she'd have a note out, I'd like a half a pint of cream today. Go back all the way down those stairs, go back to the truck, back up again to deliver it to her.
And it must have been heavy in those days because the milk was in glass bottles.
Yes, right. In fact, we can't remember where all those glass bottles went to, but every once in a while now, somebody will say to Ron or Rich, I found another Cooper Dairy bottle. You want it? Yes, we do.
So they're in the process of collecting them today.
Collecting bottles, the gallon, half gallon, quarts, pints.
Would Coopers deliver within Northampton and Florence, or only Florence, or beyond there?
They went up country, went up to we had a country route up through Chesterfield, Cummington, that way. We went over to Hadley. We branched out all through Northampton, Florence, East Hampton. I'm sure we didn't go over the Coolidge Bridge. We didn't go over that far. But went all around town in 3 days, I think it was 3 days a week.
How many people were working for the business when there were 18 trucks?
Well, of course, 18 drivers. And of course, there was at least perhaps 8 or 10 working in the plant to, pasteurize it and bottle it. And then we had a bookkeeper. And when Russ bought out Dostal's Dairy, he decided to move the plant. Well, he moved down here to Florence in 1950. He was getting too big for 126 North Maple Street. And he searched around for commercial property where he could build a dairy. And this corner lot, 3135 Main Street, was the only thing that was available. And Mr. Forsander, Gagnon Forsander's garage, owned the house, 35 Main Street, and was an empty lot there with out to Chestnut Street with a couple apple trees on it and so forth. And he says, "Hey, Oscar, how about selling me your property?" He had no idea of selling. "Well, for you, I will." So they moved down to Bay State and sold the rest of the property, and he built his dairy plant there.
What year was that?
In 1950.
And then you've been there ever since?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Was there a fire at one point?
Yes. There was an electrical fire in the plant, and early in the morning. And I can remember him getting those trucks out of there fast. And then he didn't know what he was going to do about bottling his milk, and his customers would be waiting for it. So he had belonged to this All-Star Dairies Association, and he called a friend down in Webster, Mass., Dairy Brothers. And at 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning, and by 7 o'clock in the morning, they had milk ready for him to deliver to his customers. So his customers never missed a day of delivery. He had to move his operation across the street, his bookkeeping facility across the street here to where I'm speaking now.
At 40 Main Street.
At 40 Main Street.
How long were you here at 40 Main Street?
I think about a year. And I know in the wintertime, it was the coldest sidewalk out here with the snow and the ice on it. And that was one of the jobs the boys had to do, was keep that shoveled. They didn't appreciate having to do that.
Did your family own this property?
The International Silver Company had moved out. And then the buildings were vacant, and there was going to be an auction of the buildings. And Russ knew about it, and he thought, oh, gee, that might be a good investment. So he went to his bookkeeper, Josephine Tiffany, and says, give me a blank check. She says, what are you going over there for? You're not going to bid on that, are you? He says, well, just give me a blank check. He went over, and he bid on it, and he got it for $50,000.
What year?
Do I have it down? I don't remember.
In the 1950s, maybe, yeah, or 60s? In the 50s?
Yeah.
Later 50s?
Yeah. In the early 60s, I would say.
And it included the whole?
This whole block, all the way down to the corner. And then one of the buildings was demolished, and they built the gas station there.
The Texaco gas station?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And your family then eventually sold?
He sold out in different portions of it, and portions of it to Apollo Plastics.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So he was.
And then he had to rebuild
over there.
And you at this time were living where?
It's in the house right here on the corner, 35 Main Street. And
you purchased the house at 35 Main Street
in 1950. Yeah, this whole property, and then built the dairy, and then the fire came, and then he rebuilt, and then opened up a dairy bar. Well, first of all, he opened a dairy bar in the 1950s. In May 15th, for Memorial Day, 1951. And we made our own soft ice cream and hard ice cream, and had a lunch bar there. They did well on lunch, hamburgers and specialties. And Franny Maju then was the short order cook for us then.
And that was the beginnings of Cooper's Corner,
yes,
as we know it today.
Yeah, right, right. So then we closed the dairy bar, and he wanted to make it into an office. And so closed the dairy bar, and Josephine had her office there. And then people would come in the door and say, can you go out back and get me a quart of milk, or get me a box of cottage cheese? And there were a lot of interruptions. So Russ said, well, I guess we better make a retail store here so that it won't bother the clerk so much, the secretary so much. So Marion Harlow, who lived behind us, her husband worked on the milk tanker. He picked up milk. Her son and daughter worked for us. So then he said, well, Marion, you're not working right now. How would you like to come over and work the dairy bar, or the store? Well, I don't know. I like to keep busy. I'll bring my knitting along. Well, famous last words, she never knit a stitch while she was there. If she wasn't busy with a customer, she was cleaning. She was Miss Clean all over. So anyway, that.
And you've been there ever since?
Been there ever since.
And you now live upstairs?
Upstairs over the store. And the boys, back in 80, 1980, Russ decided to retire. Oh, wait, he got the boys into the business, Eddie first. after graduating from Kentucky Wesleyan. He majored in business administration, so he worked there. And Ronnie was all, after he went to Greenfield Community College, he wanted to work on the trucks with a dairy, so he did that. And then, State Street Fruit Store became available to be purchased. Raymond Tozalowski, a real estate agent, said, "Russ, don't you want to buy another business?" And Russ says, "Heck, I'm getting about ready to retire. I don't want to buy anything," but he did. So then he said, "Well, Ron, wouldn't you like to come in the business rather than working at the dairy?" So he did. So then Rich graduated from University of Florida at Gainesville, majored in advertising. And he finished his course in 3.5 years. He applied in advertising to Channing Beat and was well received up there and worked there for about 3 months. And then when Russ had bought State Street, he said, "Oh," and this was in 74, he said to Rich, "Wouldn't you like to come and join Ron in the business?" And Rich was, you know, hesitant. He earned this job up there. And I can remember, well, Lynn, my daughter-in-law's father was around, Mr. Kleisler. And he says, "Oh, if I ever had an opportunity to own my own business, I'd jump at it." So that's what, and Rich respected Mr. Kleisler's opinion, so he joined us. And his advertising techniques have paid off. So then in 80, Russ officially retired. He says, "I'm going to retire at 62. I'm not waiting for 65. Too many of my friends have become ill at that time." So thank goodness he let the boys run the business. You can ask me any questions you want, but I'm not putting my fingers into it. So they did quite well. And so then they decided down at State Street, they'd enlarge, and there was a barbershop adjacent to it, and they joined the buildings and made a deli. And so then the store added a wine store. So then up here in 84, they decided to take away the house and add another addition to the store, make the store bigger. So they had a liquor store and a deli. And in the basement, they made a big kitchen, which last week we got 2 great big ovens in. So Peggy's now going to be able, once they get the gas hooked up, bigger, better bakery.
So you've seen tremendous growth in the family business.
Oh my goodness, yes.
Does it give you pleasure that your 3 sons have been in the business?
Oh yes, I thought it was great that they should manage so well, and I congratulate Russ for having forethought to let them do it on their own while he was still around to guide them. Because like he had seen his friend Milt Tarsus have Pioneer Valley Bottling Company, and he kept his son in the business, but he was too domineering in it, and it didn't work.
Have you, over the last 50 years, seen some changes here in the center of Florence?
Oh, yes. Speaking of the Pioneer Valley Ginger Ale Company, that's a medical building now, and I went through it when they had their grand opening, and it's just unbelievable what they did to change it and to make it so luxurious looking. Nice. And then this building here, to see you in here now where we struggled to keep warm and deliver our milk from, was wonderful. And then the Florence Diner, we used to go in there for a quick cup of coffee and so forth. And then as a student nurse down the hill near Rogers veterinary hospital, was Dick Kinner's Snack Bar. As student nurses, we used to walk up there. We didn't have much money to spend for ice cream soda, but when we did, we came up there, and that was nice. And now I'm friends with the Kinner girls, the boys' sisters. And I've been very interested in being in the Florence Congregational Church, and just fact, last October got my 50-year membership certificate. And that's from where we were married. So,
tell me a little bit about your wedding. What do you remember of your wedding day?
Well, we got married in Keene, New Hampshire. We took the minister from Forest Congregational Church with us and went over to Keene because Russ had been divorced and they weren't allowing him to live in Massachusetts for get remarried for 2 years, and this was a year later. So we went up to New Hampshire. That's where that was permitted. So we did that, and we went on a snowy February 22nd day, Washington's birthday. And we just had his parents, Grandpa and Grandma Cooper, and my dad stood up with us. And then we came back to the Bloody Brook Inn for dinner. This has since burned.
Where was that?
In South Deerfield. The Bloody Brook Inn, that was gourmet eating in those days.
Did you take a wedding trip or honeymoon?
Well, we went to our apartment and just recuperated.
Where was your apartment?
Well, our apartment was on 67 Canal Street in Brattleboro. And because being divorced, he wasn't supposed to live in Massachusetts for 2 years until the divorce was final for 2 years. Crazy rules. But anyway, so then we lived there for a year, and then he commuted back and forth here to work. And I came back to the hospital to work, too.
In those days, that was quite a commute.
Yeah, right.
What do you hope your three sons have learned from you and your husband?
Well, I know that they've learned a lot of perseverance and hard workmanship, honesty, and they're very compassionate, very loving of their families. And then, too, can't forget the birth of my children, grandchildren. I had Brian and Jonathan, and then Ronnie had Heather and Emily, and Emily has been given my maiden name for her middle name, Tyler. And then Rich had a little girl, Rebecca. She likes to be called Becca in 73. And then in 75, lo and behold, if they didn't have twins, and would you believe one weighed 8'4" and the other weighed 8'5"? Andrew and Benjamin. Now they're 5 years old, and I just visited them yesterday for 2 days up in their summer vacation cottage in Bradford, New Hampshire.
And I understand Ben has his grandfather's middle name.
Yeah, and Andrew has Kathy's brother's middle name, Robert.
It must have been a wonderful moment when your sons dedicated the Cooper's Corner.
Oh, yes.
Building to you and your husband.
Yes, and they put a cornerstone. Have you seen the cornerstone that says 1984 on it? Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, that was nice.
Were you aware that they were doing that?
No, I had no idea. And then they came out and asked me to look. I saw that written, and I was so pleased.
And I understand there was a 25th surprise anniversary party?
Oh, yes, for us. That was in 74. We had just, in January 1st, bought State Street Fruit Store, going into a strange store, waiting on customers, not asking me where the aspirin is or where the bread is or the can of beets, and not knowing. And and then come home at Sunday at 1 o'clock, and I'm getting a meatloaf ready for dinner, and Eddie calls up. He and Lynn were living over here at 35 Main Street, and he said, "What are you doing for dinner?" And I said, "I'm just getting a meatloaf ready." He says, "Put it in the refrigerator. At 2 o'clock, you've got an open house coming with possibly 200 guests." This was up at Strawberry Hill, when we lived at Strawberry Hill. I thought, "Lord, that's just all I need." But it turned out to be a fun day, but it was a snowy February 22nd day. And up at Strawberry Hill, we had a beautiful recreation basement and a big pool table that we could put a plywood plank on and decorate with a tablecloth. And Eddie Bless's Heart had so many friends and that offered to make casserole dishes and bring food in. And I think he baked the ham and the turkey. And so all the food came in. And then all these people came in. And Lynn had gotten my Christmas address book. And I belonged to the Quarter Club. And over at church, Kiwanis, Russ was in Kiwanis. they dug up everybody all over town. But we had a wonderful time, but it was a surprise. And then they had even gotten rich up from Florida.
All without you knowing about it.
Yeah, and my brother and sister-in-law came in from Cleveland.
You've had family reunions, I understand, along the way at Look Park.
Yes.
Over the years.
Oh, yes. And they started out with Hazel Chase. I cannot forget her. She is Russ's, his second cousin, really, Grampy Cooper's own cousin. Her mother was a Cooper and Grampy Cooper. And she is now 99 years old. She lives in Greenfield. But she started up these Chase Cooper reunions at Look Park. And she'd send out flyers for them every year. And we really had a wonderful time getting people together. And one time in 1955, it was in June, Rich was born in July. I was very much pregnant. And a sudden rainstorm came up, and Grandpa Cooper said, well, we can all go down to the church. He was the janitor down there, and he had key to the church, and they knew they wouldn't mind if we went into the parish hall to finish our reunion. So Russ and I left with Eddie, and we figured Grandpa and Grandma Cooper had Ronnie. We all got down to the church. Where's Ronnie? I thought you had him. No. Nope. So Russ went back up, and he was just nonchalantly being protected under one of the shelters by some strangers. So we came back and finished our reunion.
So Hazel Hawks was a very important person in your husband's life?
Oh, yes.
And yours?
Yes. Russ's mother died when he was 4, and he was an only child, and he and Grandpa Cooper went to live with Hazel's parents. At that time, Hazel was only a teenager, 18 or 19, working in the telephone company. And she took Russ under her wing. In fact, when on her dates, she and Floyd would take him for a ride with them on their dates. And then when Hazel and Floyd got married, he was their ring bearer. So, and then they had a daughter, Barbara, and so Russ was always her almost brother. And Hazel, to this day, is my favorite in-law.
Do you see her?
Oh, yeah, I try to see her at least every 2 or 3 weeks. As I say, she lives up in Greenfield. In February, she will be 100. I'm concerned about her because her eyesight isn't too good. She uses a walker. She still owns her own home. Her grandson, 2 grandsons live upstairs, so she's not alone, but I do wish she could get into some kind of extended care facility or something, because she's often said, well, grandsons are fine, but if it had been a granddaughter, it would be easier, you know. So I don't know what will happen. She often says she wishes she'd sold that big house years ago, but I do wish her well, and hope she can find something that's suitable.
Over the years, as the boys were growing up, I understand that you took a lot of vacations and some camping trips.
Oh, our first camping trip was first and last tenting trip. We went with the Bonos from up on High Street, and we went tenting up to Lake Sunapee, and it rained the whole weekend. And with 3 little ones, that wasn't any picnic. So Russ said, this is the end of our tenting. So later on, our friends the Muses had a trailer, just a 17-foot, and they said, well, why don't you come on a trip for us to Nova Scotia? And Russ had always thought, well, his wife's vacation shouldn't be made up of cooking. She should, you know, go and have meals served and so forth. But he said, I'll go along with it. I'll try. He and Chuck were good friends, so we went with them to Nova Scotia. We had a wonderful time. So then they heard about a trailer auction, and he went and bid on a Golden Nugget trailer, and that was our first trailer. And from then we went to a wilderness. We went cross country at least 3 times with it, and that was a wonderful experience. And then one of the highlights was at the Henry and Louise Addison's 40th wedding anniversary party. We knew that they had a daughter out in California and a son in the state of Washington, and Russ's daughter, Nancy, lived in Washington also. So he said, why don't we ask Henry and Louise if they wouldn't like to go cross country with us? We had the new wilderness camping trailer, and it accommodated four very nicely. So they took us up on it. And Henry is a MIT graduate, very knowledgeable. He used to work at the brush shop. And Louise, I don't know if you knew them, but Louise was in the library at UMass for many, many years. They were very knowledgeable people from Massasoit Street. Friends of Russ's from Kiwanis and from church. So they went with us. And Russ did all the driving. Louise and I did the cooking. And Henry was a wonderful map maker. I mean, he would plan the trip. And now today we can stop and see this. Tomorrow we can stop and see this. And it broke up the trip nicely. And one of the highlights was stopping back in New Orleans at the time the King Tut Museum was on display. And Louise says, oh, we've got to see that. And I thought, stuffy, ancient stuff, who wants to see that? But we went along. It was fascinating seeing King Tut's chair and all these things. And we went, the camping people had advised us to go on Wednesday because it was going to be at the library and that would be the least congested day. We went and we just, for a dollar, got in and saw all these things. It was marvelous. Then we got out to California. Oh, we stopped in New Mexico in the canyons, and we're down there on Thanksgiving Day, Carlsbad Caverns in New Mexico. Go way down deep, and there were telephones down there, so we called the boys home deep within the ground on Thanksgiving Day.
Now, eventually, as the years went on, you and your husband would vacation and then eventually retire to Florida.
Right.
So you have a lot of fond memories of those years, I'm sure.
Right. And we were camping down in Florida, and friends of ours, Russ was in the Boy Scouts, and he had talked to the Boy Scout chairman, Bob Wood, and he said, I'm going to go to Florida. I better sign some checks for you before I leave. And Bob says, whereabouts in Florida are you going? He says, well, we're going down to Gainesville, Richardson School there. And we might go down to Disney World. And he said, well, if you're down that way, stop and see my folks at Outdoor Resorts. They're staying there. So we had parked at a holiday campground in Kissimmee, went over to Outdoor Resorts to see Mr. and Mrs. Wood. When, you know, they'd pulled out the day before. But we saw this campground, and we thought, gee, maybe we could reserve this a spot for next year. And they said, well, this is really a condominium-type campground where you buy your own lot. And you own it. Well, that's not just a bad idea. So right then and there, we looked and found a spot that we liked, lot number 692, and bought it, and came down next year with our trailer. And it was just 5 miles from Disney World. And so we thought, well, this is good. So we backed the trailer in there, and Russ was disappointed because it wasn't as deep as he thought it was going to be. So as it ended up, within 6 months, we bought the lot across the street. The man was selling his lot, and it was much larger. And it had a permanent home on it, single wide. So we bought that. And we rented left our wilderness on the other lot and rented that out. And so as time went by, we went down there every year, every winter. And in the summertime, we'd go up to York Beach and stay at Libby's campground. And we had a second trailer up there, backed up to the ocean. And that was great because Russ had tinnitus, and hearing the ocean's roar seemed to relieve the roaring sound in his ear. So that was good. And then we were there, and then in 84, Russ had a sudden heart attack. And in 5 days he was gone. So our good friends, Gene and Elby Miller, were there, and they still are there from West Virginia. They're my dearest friends of all. So then Gene had just ordered a new trailer for their home. And it's a type ledger wood, which you go up to the factory and you lay out your own floor plan. So she said, you can do it. I'd never even bought a car or anything on my own, but to home went to do that, and I was so happy with it. It turned out good. Then 3 years later, in 97, friends of ours said, well, if you ever decide to sell, you know, let me be the first one to buy. Well, in the meantime, Eddie had died, and Ronnie was about to get a divorce, and I says, I don't want to be down here anymore. I want to be home. So it just so happened, sold the trailer. Mary and Glenn or Alan are so happy with it, and they're taking good care of it. And just this winter, Rich and his family were going to go to Disney World, and they said, come on, Mom, with us, and you can stay with us, and then you can spend a day over at Outdoor Resorts and seeing all your friends. So in February, I did that, and saw my old trailer, and saw how nicely they're keeping it, and visited about 10 different couples that I knew in the park. It's a large park. It has about 1,000 lots. But I had no regrets of having sold it. I was glad to be back up here with all my friends and family.
You're living a rich and full life of many experiences and ups and downs.
Been busy.
Good years and not so good years.
Yeah.
And I know you've had some losses in your family and your husband and a son. What do you think has given you your strength in life? What has helped you along the way?
Well, I just think knowing the boys love me. They show it every day.
You have a loving family.
Yeah. Yeah, and the grandkids are wonderful.
They truly are grand children.
Yes. Yeah. And that Emily, when in fourth grade, she wrote that book about my biography. Oh, gosh, I can't get over that. And then she's such a talented flutist. I'd love to hear her play.
And her sister also, very talented.
Yeah, and she plays the piano well. And they're good at in sports. Heather was in soccer. And Emily's out in soccer again.
And you have such a range in ages of your grandchildren.
Oh, yes,
from
yeah.
all grown not, up to just little ones coming
just little
along.
Ones, yeah. And Ben and Andrew are going to go into kindergarten this fall.
When you think about your grandchildren growing and moving on in life, what advice would you give them?
Just listen to what your mommy and daddy tell you. And they seem to be doing that very well, even the little ones. And don't be afraid to tackle something that you don't think is possible. You can do it. If you make up your mind, you can do it.
Do you see that in your life, where you and your husband tackled some things maybe that you weren't quite sure about?
Yes, he did especially. And from that, I gained a lot of experience, I think. Because I didn't learn to drive until he taught me after we were married. And I thought, well, I couldn't do that. And I know going through Greenfield, going up that hill, I'd always, before I go up the hill, I'd say, you could take a wheel. I don't want to go up that hill. I'm afraid I'm going to roll back. And he said, well, you can do it. So I did it.
Has anyone given you advice, or did you pick up any advice along the way that you found helpful in your own life?
I don't know. Well, I just think that my dad was a strong person who taught me a lot of things. He was a good example. And that Mary Staver, even though she wasn't a relative, she was a very kind person and taught me a lot of things. And then I think the nurse's training was good because, you know, you were kind of regimented to do that. I think some of the kids nowadays balk at that, but, you know, we just took it in our stride. A couple of the members of our class would try to stay out after hours, but that wasn't anything that interested me. I had good roommates.
You have, in your life, embraced so many people and welcomed them into your life, and I wanted to ask you about a couple of them you might want to mention. Bonnie Page. Did Bonnie Page come to
Bonnie
live?
Pope.
Pope.
Bonnie Pope came to live with us. She was a niece of Russ's cousin, Art Cooper, Art Kopar. And he and his wife wanted to take her in because she was living in a foster home. And then Priscilla, Art's wife Priscilla, got ill and couldn't take care of her anymore. So Russ said, oh, we'd like to have a little girl in our house. So Bonnie came to live with us when she was 10, and she lived with us for seven years. But, you know, that made a difference in our lives, had three boys and a girl. She was the same age as Eddie. But then she went off on her way after graduating from high school and got married and lived in Florida.
And also Russ's daughter?
Nancy, yeah.
She lived with you intermittently?
Intermittently, yes, uh-huh. And she's married a serviceman and lives out in Tacoma, Washington. Had three children. I don't see her that often, but correspond or call on the phone.
Are there some things that you're looking forward to doing?
Oh, yes, I'm going a trip. Well, I've got a trip coming up at the end of September, going with my friend Carolyn Bolvelt to Scotland and Ireland. Yes, I've had many overseas trips with friends.
You are quite a traveler, I know. I wish we'd have to do another take to cover all of those travels. When are you going to Scotland?
September 28th, or 24th to October 5th, I think it is. And but then another good experience has been elder hostel trips. Another nurse friend of mine, Gertrude Murray Lynch, who lives in Holyoke, is also widowed, and we've gone on 7 yearly hostel trips. You know, there you pick out educational courses that you consider. You don't take them for credit or anything, and you go to different spots to, you know, our first trip was to Lake George, and another one was up to Maine on the coast, and the one of the highlights was out to Glacier National Park, and we stayed out there at a place called Hibernation House, and we went over to see the grizzlies and studied the wolves and things of that sort. So
it sounds like you certainly keep extremely busy. We have only a moment, or I should say a minute or two left, and I wanted to ask you if there was anything that you had wanted to mention today that we didn't touch on. Was there anything you were hoping I would ask you that I didn't ask you?
I think it's a funny incident that when Rich was born, of course, having a third pregnancy, we were hoping for a little girl. So what does Russ bring home was a baby female dog, a baby puppy. And Skippy was our pride and joy for the longest time. We had her for 14 years.
What kind of a dog?
Husky and, well, husky and something else. Anyway, but she had a big bark, but she was as gentle as could be. And she was around here, and it was nice to have her because she would scare away anybody. And then we had a cottage at Lake Damon for 10 years that we used to go up to in summer times, and she'd go up there with us and swim across the lake. And we had wonderful parties up there and put on public suppers at the old mill and so forth. So we had a busy life.
You had three boys and Skippy.
Skippy.
Very, very busy years.
Right.
I want to thank you very much. You've done a lovely job. It's been a real pleasure to sit
here
and speak with you today.
It's been so much fun.
I know your family's going to enjoy this very much.
I hope so.
Thank you.
Thank you, Donna. Nice seeing you.